Oh, hi, welcome back. Jacorey is over there. He's thinking about representation.
Hey, so representation in media, and even that phrase is kind of ambiguous. Representation in media is basically, as I understand it, the portrayal of any party, person, or political idea in media. You give that a voice and you give it a place. When stories are made out, stories are told out of it, whether it's movies or television, you're giving it a place in the social zeitgeist almost. You're giving it a conversation piece at the table. And I think it's really important that we are very conscious of how we use our representation in media, whether it's young people, people of color, women, gay people, the LGBT community as a whole. I think it's really important that we selectively designate those roles in media and paint the narratives about how those parties are perceived. It's something I think we should really think about because it's something that has been used, I think, very negatively in the past. And I think the way that makes it very easy to think about these things is to have it in the back, have it in the back of house. When you have producers and writers and storyboards artists that are from these communities, they very naturally write their experiences into their content. But when you have a specific party holding power, like say Hollywood, Hollywood was owned by very affluent white men. And if you're outside of that, your story didn't get really told. So a lot of media we have seen in the past 100 years of television has been stories by, for, and about white men, which is kind of just, it's just representative of the world around them. That's just the stories they know. Those are stories they've told. When Tyler doesn't make it to the lacrosse team and has to figure out how he fits into the swimming team instead, those are the stories they know. So if we elevate more diverse voices, we get more diverse representation in media.
Where's that worked lately?
Have
you seen one where you're like, yes, finally?
Black Panther coming out. That's an amazing one that I'm very excited for. We haven't had a black superhero that was like strictly a black superhero. We've had like ones that we were like, hey, make that guy black. But we've never had like original stories that were black superheroes.
Like there was Iron Man's a black girl, like a teenage girl in the comics. Yeah, I don't know if it still is, but they did that. But Marvel made that a lot of those moves, but they were exactly that second thing you were talking about.
Right.
Not the like, I mean, they had Black Panther, but like they had this initiative to make it so that they had like, Thor's a girl now. Like they changed Thor as a female.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And they were like, maybe we should have a black, whatever this is.
Yeah.
But then there was a lot of criticism they got because they didn't hire black writers.
Yeah.
So it was like, oh, it's tough for like Tyrone to make it on the lacrosse team.
Yeah.
You know, because he's black.
Yeah.
And look what we're doing. But the Black Panther that they did, they gave it to Ta-Nehisi Coates and he wrote like something that became one of their top sellers because they finally like tuned into like, oh, that's how you do it.
Yeah, absolutely.
Did you see that thing on Twitter where it's like the actress, her last name is Tran, who plays like one of the people in the new Star Wars movie. Mm-hmm. She's like the Asian like heroine. And there's a moment they catch where she like sees someone dressed as her at the premiere and it's a little Asian girl and she just starts crying. And like, it's just like three photos of her just like, oh my God, this finally happened.
Yeah, that's exactly what it is. There's a phrase that's, if you see it, you can be it.
Right.
And if you see representation of something positive and that person looks like you, thinks like you, has a background like you do, has a history like you do, makes you feel like you can be that person, you can do that person. You don't have that representation, you kind of are left on your own with figuring out what you can and can't do.
Yeah, I guess it seems like at least culturally we've sort of arrived at this moment where we're like, yes, this is something we need to do. It still feels like that sort of formula of like the new superhero is the person you want to see, but it's still, the writer's room is still all white guys writing about it, whether it's Wonder Woman or whatever, which I know is a female director. But there still is this sort of heavy influence of the, you know, if we're talking specifically just in Hollywood, the male gaze of Hollywood, where, you know, it just sort of seems to permeate any productivity, you know, and so then even whatever the product that is that comes out of it is sort of affected by that. So what's the next sort of transition from, yes, we're seeing that this is something that people really want to see, but how do we really, like, is it a trust issue? Like, what's the sort of, what's the hang up in?
There's also like this weird reaction from when like people are called out for it, where they're like, we're trying, we're doing this thing that you want. There was that weird moment from Matt Damon where he's like, I forget if he was like, diversity happens in front of the camera, not behind it.
Yeah.
It's like, wait, what?
Yeah, I remember that. He was like in an airport hangar or something for whatever reason.
It was an
yeah.
interview about, I think, on the show Project Greenlight or something. Mm-hmm. And it's just like these weird things where like Hollywood is known for being this like progressive, integrating, like, you know, was Hattie McDaniel won the Oscar mm-hmm. for freaking Gone with the Wind. Like mm-hmm. that is decades and decades ago. Mm-hmm. But still, like, it's tough. It is almost that on Not in My Backyard thing where mm-hmm. you're just like, shh, but I want to keep my job.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
What happens when the rubber meets the road there?
Right.
Shit.
Right.
You know, because it's not like, well, I've spent 40 years in Hollywood and I've used every possible favor and networking thing. And I mean, I've seen people of all backgrounds work their butts off to mm-hmm. get places. Some have to work way harder than others, and yeah. some work way harder and don't get there because of exactly what you're talking about. Mm-hmm. But it's just like, so you don't see, I wonder if it's like the incentive of like, all right, you're grooming the next generation to take over after you, and people are gonna love you, white producer mm-hmm. guy, if you make it that more diverse.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Exactly. That's what I think it sort of annoys me about it, is it almost feels like it's sort of a card that people are playing, where it's like, oh, look, I'm also on the like progressive front. But really what being sort of embracing that progressive nature is make sure you have a crew of people that are sort of widely represented in terms mm-hmm. of color and gender and, you know, even on productions that sort of have a notion of this is a progressive concept, it doesn't mean that who's actually working on it is reflecting that. And I think there is that, I think that comes from, it's still not, it doesn't feel as much of a safe way of operating. And I think that's where it can still, like, we still have some like cultural progress to make, which is like, yeah, you can get that it's like a cultural grab, like, oh, we'll get a lot of people to come out to this movie because mm-hmm. half of our population is represented in this. Oh, but like, we still want the quality of work to be the best, so we're not gonna hire those people. Like,
well, one aspect of that is like Latinos go see animated movies. Mm-hmm. Like that's just a thing they've noticed. Mm-hmm. And so who did they add to Cars? There's
Cristela
a Latina,
Alonzo.
Cristela Alonzo. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And what's the last Pixar movie that came out?
Coco.
Yeah.
So it's this weird thing where like, it's a good thing. People are like, you know, the Mexican community, I saw a lot of tweets that were just like, we finally feel welcome
mm-hmm. right.
through Coco.
You're right.
And we could be this, might have been a money grab.
Yeah.
But those two things kind of work together. It's finding the like mutual incentive. If it's Disney, I don't think they're evil. I think they're like, oh, we can get two birds with one stone.
Yeah.
We can kill multiple animals now by making it a more diverse thing, which even if you could cynically say like they're doing like this reach for making people mm-hmm. like them and mm-hmm. be on the right mm-hmm. side of it. But also like, incidentally, let's pick Mexican culture because Latinos in America go see animated movies.
Right.
So if, yeah, what's, are we okay with that?
Is that?
If, I don't have the definitive word. I think in some case, like Coco, I remember specifically a lot of people said that it was very representative of Mexican families and Mexican traditions. There's a little, even little details of the tamale wrappers. They were wrapped with a thin ribbon of the corn husk that the tamales come wrapped in. Oh. And there was I believe a Mexican journalist that was writing, that used to be my job, and seeing that represented in a movie, that hit home for me. So if it's well done and appropriately done, is it still an issue?
I'm freaking fine with it. Like I feel like I'm the most, like the millennial generation ends at 1982 and mm-hmm. that's when I was born. So as the world's oldest millennial.
The world's oldest.
I would
You're
say.
You're looking right, by the way.
Thank you.
Yeah, for your age.
A few gray hairs. But it's like at this point, I'm like, do what you gotta do to mm-hmm. get it. done to make that transition. Yeah. You're not going to change people. You need allies. Just get the allies while you can.
Well, and sort of similar to what Jacorey was saying earlier, is that you don't know something's possible till you see it represented. Maybe part of this era of media is we just keep representing it, and then it sort of the normalization comes with that or comes after that. I mean, it doesn't always feel like it's the right way for something to arise, but I feel like it's similar to like the greenwashing movement, where all of a sudden it was just really hip and cool to like recycle and eat, you know, a little bit greener and all these things that in byproduct are really good for the environment and for the world. But it's not like people are really doing them for just cause, but it's still, at the end of the day, you're getting a better result from it. So, and it, you know, maybe over time people are gaining that education and getting more comfortable with things that they weren't.